necessity, this sort of, this series has to be very much of an overview and not an in-depth study of any of the many places that we've already touched on, say in the Mosaic economy. As you move on into the rest of the Old Testament period after Moses, they enter into the land under Joshua, conquer the land, and then after Joshua's death, then you have about a 300 or 350 year period under the judges, in which there's the up and downs of the Israelites, and there was no single guide or ruler over the whole of the people during that period. And as is said in the book of Judges, every man did that which was right in his own eyes, not having a central government at all. It was all left up to the individuals to make their own decisions and so forth, and they were not always good decisions. As I say, it's an up and down period, a period in which they are rising and have a judge, a good judge over them, and then after that judge is passing, then they fall back into sins and get deeply into trouble and are overridden by some of the powers from the outside, and then they call upon God and he raises them a new judge to release them from that period. And then after that comes Samuel, who is really the last of the judges. And Samuel, in a sense, like Moses, and I didn't talk about Moses in this particular respect, but I think maybe just to go back to him just very briefly, Moses stands in the place of the beginning of the fulfillment of the Abrahamic promises. God had said to Abram, you're going to become a great nation. And you see, under Moses, there are some 600,000 men said to have come out of Egypt. How many people total? Probably it's been estimated 2.5 million came out in that exodus out of Egypt. And they're given the law, and they're brought finally to the land. Though Moses is not allowed to go into the land, they, in a sense, are brought to the land that they're going to receive as an inheritance under the Abrahamic covenant. And they're about to become a nation under the Abrahamic covenant. So there's that sense in which Moses is the beginning of some of the fulfillment of the Abrahamic covenant. But Moses stands looking forward as the type of Christ, in that he performed the three offices. He was the spokesman for God. He was the prophet. He interceded in behalf of the people. He was the priest. And he was the lawgiver, the giver and ruler over the people. He was the king. And so he performed those three functions, prophet, priest, and king. And it isn't until Samuel that you have a single individual who comes and does it again. Samuel is said to be a prophet. You remember, as a boy there in the temple, he receives the prophecy in the night when Eli says, say, Lord, speak to me. And he is given a message about the fact that God's going to set Eli aside. And then he was a prophet in that very real sense, that he spoke the word of God to the people. He was a priest. He was of that family of the priest, and was raised, dedicated by his mother, and raised in the temple for that purpose of becoming a priest. And he was the judge. And so he performed the three functions. It's remarkable about Samuel, there's virtually nothing negative said about him in the scriptures. The one thing that's perhaps a negative, is that his sons were not of the same character that he was. And so Israel wanted a king to be set up over them. They didn't want Samuel's sons to be their new judges, because they felt that they would be taking bribes and so forth. And so they wanted a king. Samuel is dismayed over this request, but God says, they haven't rejected you, they've rejected me. And so God sends Samuel to anoint Saul, and Saul turns out to be the king of the human expectation. His head and shoulders over everybody else. He's just looks like the kind of person we might want as a king. Yeah, if we were thinking of it in American terms, he's the all-American boy, that type of thing. And Saul came with such a promise, but he falters and fails to obey the specific commands that were given to him by Samuel, and he's displaced from the kingship. And you remember, even while Saul is still on the throne, David is to be anointed to be king, still a shepherd boy. And he was anointed there at Bethlehem by Samuel to be king. And so Samuel has the task of anointing the first two kings. Now with David, you have essentially the completion of the conquest. Under Joshua, many of the Canaanites had not been driven out. Under Joshua and later on, under that whole period of the judges and Saul's period, the Philistines continued to be a thorn in the side of the Israelites. And they hadn't overthrown them, had not conquered them. Under David comes the conquest. And David takes the city of Jerusalem to become his capital city. And then gradually the whole of the nation is settled under David, and that the extension of his authority goes all the way to the Euphrates River and to the edge of Egypt. And under Solomon, that is, it continued. Now, during that period, you have what we would see as the beginning of a particular format of literature being gathered, namely the Psalms. Here were devotional materials, materials particularly to be sung. The word psalm actually carries that connotation, song to be sung. And so they're worship materials. Now, those who hold to exclusive psalmody maintain that this is the only songbook in Zion, and therefore this is the only book we may sing from. Some of our Presbyterian groups have that sort of a view, the Reformed Presbyterian Church, of North America, Covenanters, maintain exclusive psalmody, and some of the other smaller groups maintain exclusive psalmody. Free Church in Scotland maintain that. One of the things that I don't know that I've heard them address, I haven't studied it that deeply, but I don't know that I've heard them address, what did they sing before David's time? Did they sing nothing? We have one psalm in the Psalter, the 90th psalm, written by Moses. Is that the only one they sang? I doubt it. But at any rate, that's one of the problems with exclusive psalmody, I feel. Now, I personally think we have, in breaking from exclusive psalmody, generally American Presbyterians, as they first came to this country, were pretty much exclusive in their singing only the psalms. With the Great Awakening in the 1700s, and then the Great Revival that took place in the beginning of the 1800s, it was the effect of those revivals that brought in other music pretty largely. And the General Assembly allowed for the singing of certain hymns around the turn of the century, the beginning of the 1800s. And that got your first Presbyterian hymn book that was beyond Psalter. And after that, they didn't limit themselves to just the hymns that the General Assembly had approved. You began to get hymn books that included all sorts of hymns, many of which were not orthodox and so forth. And so what was the sad result of it is, by and large, we abandoned the Psalms altogether. I like this new Trinity hymnal. The earlier Trinity hymnal as well, both of them have included large number of the Psalms. John Murray, who was on the committee of the first Trinity hymnal, put his negative vote in against it. I think not just that it had hymns, he was an exclusive psalmist, but the fact that it didn't include all 150 of the psalms. The Christian Reformed Psalter hymnal, I believe, has some rendition of all 150. And in a way, I wish we had gone that way in the Presbyterian circles as well. The whole Psalter plus hymns. But they are integrated in this Trinity hymnal. So if you look at the bottom of the page, and it's well to do, look at the bottom of the page, and often you're singing the words of a psalm. It may be, it's given as hymn such and such, and it may have an opening line as the title of that hymn, but it actually is the words of a psalm, or it's often a paraphrase of a psalm. And I think that our Trinity hymnals have drawn us back into singing the psalms again more than we had in the old church. And that was one of the things that was sad to see us lose that, really, and it's good to see that revival of psalm singing again. What do you have in the psalms? You have the human expressions of all the religious feelings, prayer about forgiveness, about repentance, prayers of rejoicing in the Lord, devotional, thinking about the Lord as our shepherd, and those sorts of things. What you have, as I say, human expressions inspired by the Holy Spirit. And so you have in the Psalter this great collection of material that expresses virtually all the needs that we have in our worship and for worship. If you want to know how to praise God, go to the Psalter. If you want to know how to repent, go to the Psalter. If you want to know how to grieve over the loss of someone, go to the Psalter. If you want to know how to be concerned about problems of worry, go to the Psalter. And you find those things dealt with in the Psalter. And so I would commend them for your personal reading in that way, and particularly for your thinking about worship, the use of them in our worship itself. We have a minister in Brevard who is a great student of the hymn book, and his hymns are always fitted to this message so beautifully, and often he uses the Psalms as he doesn't call it to our attention so much that they're Psalms, but he's using Psalms that are expressions of the very thing he's trying to preach on. As we look at the Psalms, one of the Bonars in Scotland, of the Free Church of Scotland, has a book entitled, I think I've got the title approximately correct, Christ and His People in the Psalter. And it is his view that every one of the Psalms has reference to Christ as the Messiah and to the response of his people. Now, he may be stretching it at points as he tries to work on it, but that's a concept for us to think about. As you read any of the Psalms, how does this fit with Christ? How does it fit with me as one of his people? And how should I be responding, and so forth? Now, just to begin the Psalter itself, the opening psalm, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the wicked, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scoffers. But his delight is in the law of Jehovah, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the streams of water, that bringeth forth its fruit in its seasons, whose leaf also doth not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Now that's a description of the righteous man. And ultimately, there is no righteous man other than Jesus. Now it should be a description of us, but ultimately, you see, that's a description of the righteous man who meditates day and night upon the law of God. And his fruits, he's like that tree planted by the rivers of water, and it prospers because it's watered continuously, and his leaf does not wither, and he prospers. The wicked are not so, but like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the wicked shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. And there you reference not just to the righteous man, but the congregation of the righteous. That's God's people. That's us. Not that we have righteousness in ourselves, but we're clothed with the righteousness of Christ, and therefore can be spoken of as the congregation of the righteous. And then rather striking verse at the end, for Jehovah knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall perish. Doesn't he know what the way of the wicked is too? Yes, he knows it. But here you see this word know is used in the way in which it often is used in the Old Testament. A man knows his wife, and she conceives. It's the expression of love. And you can almost read this in that way. Jehovah loveth the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall perish. He loves the way of the righteous, the way of the wicked. He certainly knows about it, and he condemns it, and that shall perish. Now, as you look at that, it's a reference to the law. The righteous man delights in the law of Jehovah. And so, as you begin the Psalter, you have this clear reference to the law of Moses. The second psalm is more a reference to the prophets and prophecy. Why do the nations rage and the peoples meditate a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against Jehovah and against his anointed. What do you think the Hebrew word is? Messiah. You see, the word Messiah in the Hebrew, or Christ in the Greek, is to be translated by the word anointed. And the Messiah is the anointed one. And here's the introduction with that particular name now. They take counsel against Jehovah and against his anointed, saying, "Let us break their bonds asunder and cast away their cords from us." Doesn't that sound like modern America today? The pagan world does not want Christians even to have the vote, lest we impose upon them the moral standards of the Bible. They want to cast us off, and they want to cast off God and his Messiah, his anointed one. And let us break their bonds asunder and cast away their cords. And notice the answer to that. He that sitteth in the heavens will laugh. How foolish. How foolish that men think that they can set aside the living God. But that's the foolishness of men. The Lord will have them in derision. Then he will speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Just as an aside, if we end up out of this election with bad governors, Calvin says that's part of the judgment of God upon a nation. And we as Christians can be assured that whichever way this thing goes, whether we get a righteous governor or an unrighteous governor, it's in the hands of God. And if America deserves wicked governors, unrighteous, wicked, bad governors, it would be in part the judgment of God upon this nation, which is turning its back upon God. And I think we can just accept as sovereignly given to us if the election should be declared in that direction, accept the fact that this is part of God's judgment upon us. And if, on the other hand, he spares us that and gives us those who would seek to turn us back towards the more Christian principles upon which the nation was founded, then we can rejoice and pray that there could be a true spiritual awakening coming in the land. But he answers in the verse 6, "Yet I have set my king upon my holy hill of Zion." That's the Messiah. He's to be the king. "I will tell the decree." And here the psalmist now moves from God speaking against the nations to God speaking, God the Father speaking to his anointed. "I will tell of the decree. Jehovah said unto me, Thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. Ask of me, and I will give thee the nations for thine inheritance, and he and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel." And so here's the decree. I think it's a decree particularly having to do with his messianic office. It's not saying that he began to be the Son of God. You see, we believe that. And the Nicene Creed that you recite occasionally here uses that language, the eternally God, very God of very God. He was already God. And he's always been the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity. He's always been the Son of God. He didn't begin to be the Son of God at any point. So we speak of eternally begotten, language in our catechisms and confession, going back to the early councils. Eternally begotten. And that seems to be sort of a impossible. How's that possible? Begotten, and yet that to be eternally so. Well, they recognize the word begotten carried with it perhaps some subordination. And so to avoid that subordination, they added the word eternally begotten and eternally eternal procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father and from the Son. And so we understand then that he didn't ever begin to be. The Godhead has always been triune, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that a relationship of the Father to the Son was the eternal one of eternally begotten and eternal sonship, and the Holy Spirit eternally proceeding from the Father and the Son. So when he's saying, "This day have I begotten thee," is not so much the beginning of his deity or beginning of his being the second person of the Trinity. It's more the idea of, "This day have I begotten thee as my Son, the mediator of the new covenant, the covenant of grace. And so you have that announcement. And you know, Jesus, at the time of the baptism, God the Father comes and says, "Behold my Son in whom I well please." And that's, in a sense, the public declaration with regard to him, that this word that had been spoken within the Trinity is now publicly announced at the baptism of Jesus. So here you have a messianic psalm. And if the first psalm referred to the law, what's the second psalm referring to? The prophets of the Old Testament. You see, there's a unity. Now, the Hebrews often divided the Old Testament into the law, the prophets, and the writings. And the writings began with the Psalter. And what I am suggesting, there's a unity between the three parts. Here you have the law in the first psalm, the prophets in the second psalm. And this is the beginning of this whole third section of the literature of the Old Testament, the writings, the wisdom writings, and the psalms, and so forth. And so you can see that unity of the Old Testament in the very beginning and the placing of these psalms and the way in which they're placed. Frankly, I would maintain that the order of the Psalter was inspired as well as the individual psalms as you move through it. Now, as you move along in the Psalter, it would be hard for us to cover everything that would be well worth our covering. Perhaps the eighth psalm might be a good one, familiar to all of you. O Jehovah our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory upon the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou established strength, because of thine adversaries, that thou mightest still the enemy and the avenger. When I consider thy heavens and the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visitest him. You remember a couple of the astronauts, I think the first trip around the backside of the moon, came out saying that, reading this passage. When I consider the moon and the stars which thou hast made, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visitest him. For thou hast made him but a little lower than, literally it's Elohim, the word God. You find it translated in the New Testament by the word angels. And the passage is applied to Jesus in the book of Hebrews as his being made a little lower than the angels. In the incarnation, he's made human. For thou hast made him a little lower than God or the angels, and crownest him with glory and honor. Thou hast made him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet. Now that, you see, would be true of the original formation of man. He was to have sovereignty over the whole world. He said all the world's to be in subjection to him. But now in particular, Christ is the one to whom all authority has been given in heaven and in earth. And he has, in particular, all authority. But then we now, particularly as Christians, ought to be exercising that same sort of authority. You men who are here working in the lab, you're working in that area of the creation mandate of subduing the earth, of studying the creation that God has given us and determining how we can use this portion of it or that portion of it in ways to obtain energy and so forth. What you're doing is following the creation mandate in doing that. And even fallen man continues to do that. He does it with his own greed and so forth and misuses it. But God would have us properly to subdue this earth that he has created and is proper thing for us to do. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet. All sheep and oxen, yea, the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, the fish of the sea, whatsoever passeth through the paths of the seas. O Jehovah our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. So a passage that's both messianic in its character, speaking about the one who is made a little lower than the angels, but true about all of us as human creatures made in the image of God, lower than the angels, that we are to be exercising that sort of dominion over the earth that he has given to us. Moving on again to familiar Psalm, the Psalm 19. We Reformed people believe that God has ceased to give special revelation since the time of the close of the canon of the New Testament. Now, when the trumpet sounds, special revelation will be beginning again. You're going to see Christ manifest himself, and we will have the heavens opened, as it were, to us, and we'll be seeing that special revelation. But for the time being, we believe this period is a period in which he has ceased to give special revelation, and the special revelation we have is contained here. But don't fall into the trap, and I've heard sometimes Reformed students who will say this, God has ceased to give revelation. Read Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Every day, God is revealing himself to the world in the heavens above us and in the whole world. All the trees, the plants, the whole world of nature is the revelation of God. It's what we speak of as general revelation instead of special revelation. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language. Their voice is not heard. Everybody sees it. It can be in Africa, and they may speak different languages, but they know about the sun rising and setting. They know about the stars and the planets and the moon and so forth. They have seen this, and they see something that's beyond them. And God is showing himself to the whole of creation. The heavens declare the glory of God. And it speaks then of the figure of the sun. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he hath set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run his course. His going forth is from the ends of the heavens, and his circuit unto the ends of it. And there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. And so there is your general revelation. Now the psalmist turns back to special revelation. The law of Jehovah is perfect, restoring the soul. The testimony of Jehovah is sure, making wise the simple. And where do you find that? In his written word. That's what this is talking about. The precepts of Jehovah are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of Jehovah is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of Jehovah is clean, enduring forever. The ordinances of Jehovah are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the droppings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned. In keeping them there is great reward. And here you see the psalmist applies this now. He recognizes this is the nature of God's revelation. It's delightful. It is a light to us, enlightening our eyes. And it's the means by which we can be warned against sin. And then he, in a sense, is saying, and moreover, by them is thy servant warned. So he is of the people of God. He's warned against sinning again. In keeping them, there's great reward. Who can discern his errors? Clear thou me from hidden faults. And then something so applicable to us as Christians. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. You know, it's not the non-Christian who is likely to commit presumptuous sins. He's just forgetting God, period. But it's we Christians who believe in Christ as our Savior, and we will justify, well, I know this is really not right, but I can get away with it. And we presume upon God's grace. And the psalmist prays specifically that God would keep us from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. And Paul in Romans 6 ends or a section that he's dealing with in the early part of that chapter, I think it's verse 11, that we are to reckon ourselves to be dead unto sin and alive unto God. Sin is not to have dominion over us, but rather it is dead. And we are dead to it. And it doesn't have power over us. And so we ought not to let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be clear from great transgressions. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Jehovah, my rock and my redeemer. Now we've seen already that the figure of the rock from the Mosaic period was pointed to Christ. And ultimately, he is the means by which you and I can confess our sins and be cleansed and be clear of great transgression. And it is as we rest upon him as our rock, and in particular, as our Redeemer. You know, as you think about the Lord's table, all of the elements on that table are bloodless. They don't have any blood to prepare that bread or the wine. But what do they point to? The death of Christ. I asked my class just the other day, why is that the case? Why doesn't it point to the resurrection of Christ? And one of them came up with the right answer. He says, because we are sinners and that's what we need. We need the death of Christ to take care of our sins. And you see, he's our Redeemer. He's paid the price for our sins. And so how can we make this confession? Keep back thy servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright. Only if we're resting upon the rock and upon the redemption that Christ has earned upon the cross. And so here's a psalm that's talking about the revelation, the general revelation, the special revelation, but culminates in a sense in the final revelation of God, namely the revelation in the Lord Jesus as the rock and our Redeemer. Now, as you turn the page on into the next section, the 22nd, 23rd, 24th Psalms. 23rd is perhaps the favorite chapter of most people, even of non-Christians, that know anything about the literature of the Bible. But let me submit to you, you can't have the 23rd without the 22nd. And you can't have the 23rd without the 24th. And I think we need to read them and see that context. 22nd were the words that Jesus was quoting on the cross. It opens, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? You can get something of the picture of what Jesus was undergoing in these words. Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou answerest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and no man. You see, that's what happened to Jesus. Our sins were placed upon him, and he was counted as sin in our stead. And he can't claim now, and he can't come on his own, as it were. He's a worm, a reproach unto men, and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. And that happened on that day of the crucifixion. They shoot out the lip, they shake the head, saying, commit thyself unto Jehovah, let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, seeing he delighteth in him. And that happened, you remember, on the cross. When he made this cry, they said, maybe, let's see if his God will come and save him. Let him rescue him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me trust when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God since my mother bare me. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. And he had no help. He had to bear this entirely by himself. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me around. And they gape upon me with their mouth as a ravening and roaring lion. I'm poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. And people have said that's the way a crucifixion would affect a person. He would be thirsty, poured out like water, and all of his bones out of joint, hanging there upon the nails, and all of his bones come out of joint, as it were. My heart is like wax, it is melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws. And thou hast brought me unto the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me, a company of evildoers have enclosed me. They pierced my hand and my feet. My hands and my feet. I may count all my bones. They look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them. And upon my vesture do they cast lots. And the gospel writers, recognizing that when that took place, said this was a fulfillment of Scripture. Seeing that these very words then, this very event took place just as it was described here in this psalm. But be not far off, thou afar off, O Jehovah. O thou my succor, haste thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, yea, from the horns of the wild oxen. Thou hast answered me. And there perhaps is already the note of victory. As I said earlier, when he cries out those words, it's not just, O God, but it's, O my God, why hast thou forsaken me? There's already that note of his ongoing faith, even from the depths of hell. Because you see, I think that's essentially what he was suffering. He was suffering the anguish of hell. He described hell in terms of a place of outer darkness. And that's what had happened to him there on the cross. The sun was darkened. And for those 3 hours, he was in total outer darkness. He was in hell itself, in that place upon the cross. But he is declaring, in a sense, God has heard him. And what's he going to do? I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the assembly will I praise thee. Yea, ye that fear Jehovah, praise him. All ye the seed of Jacob, glorify him. And stand in awe of him, all ye seed of Israel. For he hath not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither hath he hid his face from him. But when he cried unto him, he heard. Of thee cometh my praise in the great assembly. I will pay my vows before them that fear him, and the meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise Jehovah that seek after him. Let your heart live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn unto Jehovah. And there you see that prophecy that's going far beyond just his being relieved of the death. He's going to go down to hell and be relieved of that punishment. He's going to die and have paid that price. But one of the things, the benefits that occurs, is that all the ends of the earth are going to hear of this. And we're in that period when that's going on right now. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn unto Jehovah, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. For the kingdom is Jehovah's, and he's the ruler over the nations. All the fat ones of the earth shall eat and worship. All they that go down to the dust shall bow before him. Even he that cannot keep his soul alive, a seed shall serve him. It shall be told of the Lord unto the next generation. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born that he hath done it. And there's the victorious note. He has paid the penalty. And he's coming forth out of it and declaring the righteousness of God and the glory of God and calling upon the peoples of the earth to glorify him in that way. Now, the next psalm is very familiar to you, though you probably are not aware that the name that it opens with is Jehovah. That's the covenant name of God. God was the covenant-keeping God. And it's particularly that personal name of God that is said to be my shepherd. Jehovah is my shepherd, I shall not want. Now, as we look at that, let's turn over to Ezekiel chapter 34, which is one of the great shepherd passages. In the first part of this chapter, there is the condemnation of the false shepherds of Israel. And then beginning with verse 11, for thus saith the Lord Jehovah, behold, I myself, even I, will search for my sheep and will seek them out, as a shepherd seeketh out his flock in the day that he is among his sheep that are scattered abroad, so will I seek out my sheep, and I will deliver them out of all the places whither they have been scattered in the cloudy and dark day. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land, and I will feed them upon the mountains of Israel by the watercourses and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and upon the mountains of the heights of Israel shall their fold be. There shall they lie down in a good fold, and on fat pasture shall they feed upon the mountains of Israel. I myself shall be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will cleanse them, or cause them to lie down, saith the Lord Jehovah. I will seek that which was lost, and will bring back that which was driven away, and will bind up that which was broken, and will strengthen that which was sick. But the fat and the strong I will destroy, and I will feed them in justice. As for you, O my flock, thus saith the Lord Jehovah, behold, I judge between sheep, and the sheep and the rams and the he-goats. Seemeth it a small thing unto you to have fed upon the good pastures, but ye must tread down with your feet the residue of your pasture, and have drunk the clear waters, but you must foul the residue with your feet? As for my sheep, they eat that which ye have trodden with your feet, and they drink that which ye have fouled with your feet. Therefore, thus saith the Lord Jehovah, behold, I, even I, will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. And so he goes on to speak about his coming in judgment against the false shepherds of Israel. I think it would still be applicable to the false shepherds in the church in this day and age as well. Verse 24, I, Jehovah, will be their God. Genesis 17:7. David prince among them. I, Jehovah, have spoken it. And so the idea that David is going to be the prince that is going to be the shepherd as well. And so you have that picture of the shepherding work that is there. Now to go back to the 23rd Psalm, Jehovah is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth my soul, me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He guideth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And then he changes the figure from the shepherd with the sheep. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou hast anointed me with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and loving kindness shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of Jehovah forever. It's a beautiful psalm, as we all know, speaking of the comfort of the shepherd, and to realize that he is the one who is Jehovah. And I think, of course, this is one of those passages that quite clearly is speaking of the Messiah. And Jehovah's Witnesses say that he's never called Jehovah. Jesus never called him Jehovah. It seems to me this is one of those that clearly calls him Jehovah. And you might want to point that out to them. Go back to the 34th chapter of Ezekiel and see that it's David who is the shepherd and God who is the shepherd, Jehovah God who is the shepherd. And hear this passage as well. And of course, the Isaiah passage that he shall lead his flock is a beautiful passage that fits with it as well. Then the 24th Psalm, I'd say all of these you really have to have together. Can't just have Jesus as the shepherd and the comforter without having him as king. The earth is Jehovah's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend unto the hill of Jehovah? And who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto falsehood, hath not sworn deceitfully. He shall receive a blessing from Jehovah. And ultimately, again, that describes only one. Only the Lord Jesus has been that perfect man, clean hands, pure heart. And we become clean and cleansed by coming to him as our Savior and are clothed with his righteousness. And this is the generation of them that seek after him, that seek thy face, even Jacob. And then this beautiful language, and probably the psalm was written at the time that David was bringing the ark into the city of Jerusalem. And it may well have been sung at that time. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. And you can see them, the choir is singing there. And lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in. Who is the King of glory? Jehovah, strong and mighty. Jehovah, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, yea, lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in. Who is this King of glory? Jehovah of hosts. He is the King of glory. And that may well have been the first setting of it. But as one of the commentators has said, maybe more than one, it may well be descriptive of the angels as Jesus is returning to glory. And you can hear them singing there at the battlements of heaven, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in. Who is this King of glory? Jehovah, strong and mighty. Jehovah, mighty in battle. That's the Lord Jesus. He's conquered. He's gone to the earth. He's paid the penalty. He's come forth conquering death and grave and Satan and sin. All of that he's conquered. And he's Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Yea, lift them up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of glory will come in. Who is this King of glory? Jehovah of hosts. He is the King of glory. And so as you see that in the messianic context, and perhaps those very words used as the angels welcomed Jesus back to heaven from his earthly sojourn, the praising of him for his victory and the glory that he has as our Savior. Psalm 32 is a good psalm talking about the matter of our forgiveness and the fact that God doesn't impute our sins to us, and the struggle that David had, probably having to do with his sin with Bathsheba. Verse 5, I acknowledge my sin, or verses 3 and following, when I kept silence, my bones wasted away. Through my groaning all the day long, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me, my moisture was changed as the drought of summer. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity did I not hide. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto Jehovah, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. And then if you go back now and read the first verses, blessed is the man, is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom Jehovah imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. And so here is a passage, if you want to know how to confess sin, read it. Read the Psalm 32 and see that psalm as one of describing how to confess and to come to the Lord. And then the result, forgiveness and willingness now to serve him. Psalm 45 is one of those that's clearly a messianic psalm, having to do with the marriage of the king. My heart overfloweth with a goodly matter. I speak the things which I have made touching the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. Thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured into thy lips. Therefore God hath blessed thee forever. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O mighty one. And there this one is seen as a warrior. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O mighty one, thy glory and thy majesty. And in thy majesty rule on prosperously because of truth and meekness and righteousness. And thy right hand shall teach thee terrible things. Thine arrows are sharp. The peoples fall under thee. They are in the heart of the king's enemies. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. You see, it transcends then. It rises above the Israelitish kings, and this is one who is addressed as God. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of equity is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. And there's that language of being anointed again. This is the anointed one that's being spoken of as the one who is upon this throne. God thy God hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. All thy garments smell of myrrh and aloes and cassia. Out of ivory palaces stringed instruments have made thee glad. King's daughters are among thy honorable women. All thy right hand and at thy right hand doth stand the queen of gold of Ophir. Hearken, O daughter, and consider, and incline thine ear. Forget also thine own people and thy father's house. So will the king desire thy beauty, for he is thy Lord, and reverence thou him. And the daughter of Tyre shall be there with a gift. The rich among the people shall entreat thy favor. The king's daughter within the palaces are all glorious. Her clothing is wrought with gold. She shall be led unto the king in broidered work. The virgins have her companions that follow her shall be brought unto thee. With gladness and rejoicing shall they be led. They shall enter into the king's palace. Instead of thy fathers shall be thy children, whom thou shalt make princes in all the earth. I will make thy name to be remembered in all generations. Therefore the peoples shall give thanks forever and ever. So it's a messianic passage, particularly about the kingship, the crowning of the king, and the marriage of the king, and ultimately the church may be viewed in this figure of the bride that is brought into the king. Psalm 72 celebrates the kingship particularly. And this, you'll notice, is a song of Solomon, as distinguished from most of the earlier psalms or psalms of David. Here's a song of Solomon, and it describes something of the glory of the kingship that he has. Give the king thy judgments, O God, and thy righteousness unto the king's son. He will judge thy people with righteousness, and thy poor with justice. The mountains shall bring peace to the people, and the hills in righteousness. He will judge the poor of the people, and he will save the children of the needy, and will break in pieces the oppressor. They shall fear thee while the sun endureth, and so long as the moon throughout all her generations. He will come down like the rain upon the mown grass, and showers that water the earth. In his days shall the righteous flourish, and the abundance of peace, till the moon be no more. He shall have dominion also from sea to sea, and from the river unto the ends of the earth. And there you see his kingship is not just a local kingship of Solomon, but it is a kingship that extends to the ends of the earth. The picture of this universal kingship. It's this kind of psalm that particularly would cause those who hold to the post-millennial view of the church and of the coming of Christ, that the church is going to gain this sort of a victory over the whole world. And I remember asking Mr. Rushdoony, he came to Reformed Seminary, I said, read us some of the passages that you based your post-millennialism on. He read out of this psalm, for example. And he said, it's never been yet fully fulfilled. It's going to be. That was his declaration. It's going to be fulfilled. And the post-millennialism has that beauty of that optimism and the feeling that these passages are literally going to take place. He shall have dominion also from sea to sea and from the river unto the ends of the earth. So that sort of a note about the glories of the kingship of the Messiah. Now, Psalm 89 is an interesting one. And in connection with that, let me get you to go back with me to 2 Samuel chapter 7. David had said he wanted to build a temple for the Lord. And Nathan, in the opening verses of chapter 7 of 2 Samuel, says, see now, I dwell in the house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. And Nathan said to the king, go do all that is in thy heart, for Jehovah is with thee. Nathan didn't have the revelation from God there other than just to encourage him. And David says he wants to build a house for the Lord. And it's in particular in verses 13 through 16, you have something of the response. He shall build a house. He's talking about the seed of David going to do this. Moreover, verse 11, second half, moreover, Jehovah telleth thee that Jehovah will make thee a house. When thy days are fulfilled and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, and they shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. And I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commit iniquity, now that certainly is not applicable to the Messiah, but to the line that from which the Messiah was to come, the son, the seed of David, the physical seed. I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the stripes of the children of men, but my loving kindness shall not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I put away before thee. And thy house and thy kingdom shall be made sure forever before thee. Thy throne shall be established forever. According to all these words and according to all this vision, so did Nathan speak unto David. Now, Psalm 89 celebrates this in words that are not used in that passage in 2 Samuel. Opening verses there. I will sing of the loving kindness of Jehovah forever. With thy mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. For I have said, mercy shall be built up forever. Thy faithfulness wilt thou establish in the very heavens. I have made a covenant with thee, or with my chosen. I have sworn unto David my servant, thy seed will I establish forever, and build up thy throne to all generations. The language of covenant is introduced by the psalmist here, which was not used in Samuel. And it's again referred to towards the end of the psalm again. He speaks about this covenant with David. Let me see, I don't spot it right quickly. Here, verse 34. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that is gone out of my lips. Once have I sworn by my holiness, I will not lie unto David. His seed shall endure forever, and his throne as the sun before me. It shall be established forever as the moon, and as the faithful witness in the sky. And so you have then this interesting phenomenon that a later theologian, as it were, considering what God had said to David in Samuel, where Nathan didn't use the word covenant, and under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, of course, he now speaks of it in terms of a covenant. Dr. Palmer Robertson, in the little book that was referred to at the beginning of this hour, argues that it is legitimate on this sort of an analogy for us to talk about the relation of God with Adam in the Garden of Eden as a covenant. Because all the terms and conditions of a covenant, parties of the covenant, and conditions, and a threat, and a promise, all of that is there. It's not called a covenant of works in Genesis. But Dr. Robertson thinks, just as this was not called a covenant with David in Samuel, but when the psalmist comes to meditate upon it, he calls it a covenant, says that God has established a covenant with David to have someone sit upon his throne forever. Of course, that's the Messiah, ultimately. Christ is the one who is the seed of David. And so I think Dr. Robertson, I think, has given a good argumentation for being willing to use the language of our confession in describing the covenant of works, or as the catechism speak of it as also as the covenant of life, being that probation in which Adam was put upon the testing of whether he'd eat the tree or not. It's a legitimate analogy that here something is called a covenant that was not first called one, but that term is applied later as it's considered more fully. But certainly this is messianic. The idea that one shall sit upon the throne of David is a matter that becomes part of the Israelite eschatology, they considered from that time on that this had to be the case, that there would be one who would sit upon the throne of David. And you have in the prophecies, particularly after this, many of those prophecies, and we'll see some of those tomorrow as we look at the prophecies in Isaiah and so forth, many of those prophecies are hinged upon the Davidic covenant, the promises to the seed of David, and the fact that this royal one is going to come. And these become a very prominent part of your messianic prophecies after this time. Remember in the Gospels, both Matthew and Luke, that give the genealogies, stress the idea that Jesus is out of that line of David, and that these are the generations of Jesus. In Matthew 1:17, so all the generations from Abraham unto David are 14 generations, from David unto the carrying away to Babylon 14 generations, from the carrying away to Babylon unto the Christ 14 generations. But you see the emphasis of this line coming down through Abraham to David to the Christ. And that it becomes a prominent motif, really, of the prophecies that follow after this. Now, just a couple of other psalms that I would call to your attention. One to which I referred earlier today when we were talking about the scapegoat. That 103rd psalm really is a celebration of the gospel promises. Bless the Jehovah, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless Jehovah, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. And then you begin to think about it. These are gospel promises. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy desires with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the evil. Jehovah executeth righteous acts and judgments for all that are oppressed. He made known the ways unto his ways unto Moses, his doings unto the children of Israel. Jehovah is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us after our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his loving kindness toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. You see, I think essentially what happened on the cross, Jesus went into hell in that outer darkness as the scapegoat was sent out into the wilderness. And Jesus, when he came out of that outer darkness, had paid the full price of our sins, and they, as it were, left in hell. And they're not going to be called up and brought back again upon us. He's paid the price and the full penalty for our sins. So as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Like as a father pitieth his children, so Jehovah pitieth them that fear him. For he knoweth our frame, he remembereth that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass, as the flower of a field, so he flourisheth. For the wind passeth over it, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. But the loving kindness of Jehovah is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those that remember his precepts to do them. God hath established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom ruleth over all. Bless Jehovah, ye his angels, that are mighty in strength, and that fulfill his word, hearkening unto the voice of his word. Bless Jehovah, all ye his hosts, ye ministers of his that do his pleasure. Bless Jehovah, all ye his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless Jehovah, O my soul. And so he's celebrating the blessings of God in his gracious provision of salvation that removes our sins. And ultimately that comes only in the Messiah. The last of the passages that I specifically look at is the 110th Psalm. Jesus addressed the Jews and said, whose son is the Messiah? And they wanted to say he's the son of David. And Jesus says, then how does he say this? Jehovah said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. Jehovah will send forth the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. Thy people offer themselves willingly in the day of thy power in holy array. Out of the womb of the morning thou hast the dew of thy youth. Jehovah hath sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. The Lord at thy right hand will strike through kings in the day of his wrath. He will judge among the nations. He will fill the places with dead bodies. He will strike through the head of head in many countries. He will drink of the brook in the way. Therefore will he lift up the head. Now, particularly the first verse speaking about the Messiah, and that he is addressed as Lord by Jehovah, and he's to sit upon the right at his right hand, and the power and his control over all and authority over all things. And then also the passage that Jehovah hath sworn will not repent, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. This is probably, I think it is, the most quoted of all the Psalms in the New Testament. It's quoted in places with references to both of these different passages. And in particular, in the book of Hebrews, you have this matter of the priesthood of Melchizedek. The priesthood of the Messiah is touched on in the end of the fourth chapter of Hebrews, where he is the basis for our coming to the throne of glory of God with boldness. Having then a great high priest that who hath passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession, for we have not a high priest that cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but one that hath been in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore draw near with boldness unto the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and may find grace to help us in the time of need. So he's declaring the priesthood of Christ as the ground for our being able to approach the throne of God as a throne of mercy and a throne of grace. Why? Because he's paid the penalty, he's made the sacrifice, and he's also now on the throne of God as a priest with a feeling of all of our infirmities. Then he begins to describe what is a priest. For every high priest being taken from among men, one of the requirements is that he be a man, not an angel or not some other creature, but that he would be one from among us. Taken from among men is appointed for men to bring in things pertaining to God. So you remember the arrow pointing upward. He is appointed to represent us as he approaches God with regard to our needs, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins, and who can bear gently with the ignorant and erring, for that he himself also is compassed with infirmity, and by reason thereof is bound as for the people, so also for himself to offer for sins. Now that was true of the Aaronic priesthood. On the Day of Atonement in particular, he had to offer sacrifices for his sins of the past year, so that he would be cleansed and ready to move into the new year. And no man taketh the honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, even as was Aaron. So Christ also glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but he that spake unto him, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. That's the second psalm. And as he saith also in another place, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And so the 110th psalm then, who in the days of his flesh, having offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save even from death, having been heard for his godly fear, though he was a son, yet learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became unto all them that obey him the author of eternal salvation, named of God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Now that's the fifth chapter of Hebrews, and you go on through, and the sixth chapter continues to deal with, and the seventh chapter, and the eighth chapter. So this matter of the priesthood of Melchizedek is a matter of good deal of study and consideration by the author of Hebrews in these next three chapters. And it is the fact that Jesus is a high priest of a higher order even than that of Melchizedek. And because of his priestly work, we have access to God and to that throne as a throne of grace and a means of salvation. If you go back to that passage in Hebrews 4, the end of it, that we might receive mercy and help. First thing that we need is mercy, because we are sinners. And the first thing we need that God deals with is our sin before he deals with us in other matters. And then after that, that we may receive help in our times of need. And we are encouraged on the basis of the priestly work of Christ to bring all of our needs to Christ and to God through Christ. And a promise of help is given there in that passage. Promise of help to us. It may not always be the thing we are asking for, but God will help us as we best need to be helped in our particular circumstances. Again, this has only covered some of the passages lightly. I felt it would be worth reading portions of the Psalms because of the beauty of their language and the way they do apply these passages and these thoughts to our hearts and minds. And I trust that God will have blessed you through his word and through his spirit. Are there questions anybody would want to ask either about the first or the second lecture of today? Yes, sir. Not always. Jehovah is my shepherd is the Messiah, second person. But that reference to Jehovah saying that he's to sit upon the throne, it is the Father who's being called the Jehovah in that case. You see, the word Jehovah is a name for the Godhead, and any person of the Godhead could be properly described that way. Our Jehovah's Witness friends don't recognize that the second person, or don't recognize the Trinity, and therefore they don't recognize that the second person is ever called Jehovah. But I think he is, very clearly. So yes? I think so. I think that Psalm 24, if it's properly understood, is possibly referring to the return of Jesus. Who is this Lord of glory? He is Jehovah. He is the one who is going to come in. He's none other than the Messiah, but he's none other than God himself. So the second person of the Trinity, I think, may be properly designated by the word Jehovah. Second Corinthians 2:8. I have to look that one up. I'm not sure exactly how that reads. Wherefore I beseech you to confirm your love, am I right in this, toward him. 1 Corinthians 2:8. All right. I almost need to read, let me read verse 7 and 8. But we speak God's wisdom in a mystery, even the wisdom that hath been hidden, which God foreordained before the worlds unto our glory, which none of the rulers of this world hath known, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, things which eye saw not, and ear heard not, and which entered not into the heart of man, whatsoever things God prepared for them that loved him. So it is speaking about the fact that the world does not recognize and understand that the Lord's anointed was the Lord himself, Jehovah himself. I think that is proper to see that. And had the world known it, in a sense, the implication would be that they should have acted in a way so as not to crucify the Lord of glory. Of course, I'm not sure as you think about the total sinfulness of man, the world might know it and rebel against it. And try just as Herod did, found out where the Messiah is to be born, and I will destroy him. And he goes in and kills everybody 2 years of age and under, so that he can be sure that he's caught that child that had been born and that star had shown over. He couldn't catch him in that 2 year span. It's probably double the span that they needed. But he was trying to overcome God's promise of the Messiah. The devil is constantly trying to do that. And even after the Messiah comes, the devil then takes him out and tempts him and seeks to get him to bypass his messianic work by taking one of the shortcuts that the devil promises him. And of course, he won't be tempted in that way. All right, other questions? Yes, ma'am. Psalm 78. You remember just where it is that? Give ear, O my people, to my law. Incline thine ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not hide then from their children, telling to the generation to come the praises of Jehovah and his strength and his wondrous works that he hath done. Now, your question is this, words of the Messiah? Is that what your question is? Or these words that Jesus could take? He did speak in parables, and as you read the gospel accounts about the parables, it was in order, on the one hand, that his disciples be enlightened, and those who were not his disciples not understand. He says both with regard to that. Utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard. But then he goes on to say that this is going to be something that's going to become revealed to the world, isn't it? And that certainly is true of the gospel, that it has become revealed to the world. Many of the Jews in Jesus' day did not understand it, but by and large, the world, even the non-Christians, know what the gospel says. They know that we believe Jesus is the Son of God, that he died, that he rose again from the dead. Even though they don't believe it. I've heard occasionally a comedy show on the television in which they're mocking the Christian faith, but they describe that part of it accurately. And then they make some snide remark that the congregation or the audience laughs at. But they understand the words of what we believe. It was interesting during the period of the Iranian hostages that they said they would allow chaplains to go visit those hostages at both Christmas and Easter. Now they, I think mistakenly, but they thought that these are truly Christian holidays, and therefore these people needed the help of their spiritual leaders on those days. But the Iranians, Muslims by and large, knowing that we have this account of both the birth of Jesus and of his death and resurrection. And they don't believe it, but they know that's what we believe. And for that reason, they were being gracious and letting us to send chaplains to the hostages at those times. So that there is that sense in which the whole world already basically knows the gospel message. It's been published now for 2,000 years. And those who reject it out of the hardness of their hearts, their sinfulness, rejection out of that hardness. And those who receive it, of course, it's the free offer of the invitation of Jesus, that come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And that's said right after he just said, only those whom he reveals the gospel to are going to come. Thanks God for having hidden it from some and revealed it to others. Yea, Father, for so it was well-pleasing in thy sight. In the same breath, an invitation that's offered to all. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. So we who hold to the sovereignty of God, predestination, those doctrines, hold them because the Bible teaches them. And we hold also to the invitation of the gospel freely offered to sinners. That doesn't mean we believe they can receive it without the help of the Holy Spirit. Child's Catechism really is very pointed on that. It says, who can change the sinner's heart? The answer is the Holy Spirit alone. We can't, the preacher can't change it, parents can't change it, child can't change it. But the Holy Spirit alone, that's the rebirth is required in order for a person to come to be a Christian. And then he must come and respond by repentance and faith in Jesus. So again, I would make that clear to you that if any of you are outside of Christ, the invitation is freely offered to you to come unto him and receive salvation. And then for those of us who know him, I trust that we have truly been helpful in opening some of these passages to you. Perhaps one of the things I could hope might happen, some of you might say, well, let's pursue this particular thing more fully and get into the Psalms more fully, get into the typology of the Day of Atonement or of the Tabernacle and so forth more fully. Because this kind of thing is just a touching of lightly on these doctrines, and just with the hope that it'll stimulate you into more Bible study and more serious study of these matters. Any announcements that we need?
Just lunch.
Lunch is to be served at right now, 2 minutes from now. Let's close with prayer. Let's stand with closing prayer. Again, our Heavenly Father, we have feasted at thy table of thy word, and we trust by thy Holy Spirit we have been fed and have grown and have understood more of the teachings of thy word concerning our Savior, and how we thank thee for thy provision of him for us as sinners. And we come to repent of our sins and to trust in Jesus as our Savior, and to pray that thou would bless these thoughts to our hearts as we continue to meditate upon them this day and the days that lie ahead of us. Bless us as we approach the Sabbath day. Guide and direct us that we might properly prepare for that day and be able to worship thee and to take a godly rest before thee on that day. And bless now the food that we will be partaking of, and bless the hands that have prepared it, and bless us in our fellowship together. And we ask it in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Thank you all for coming.